Welcome to another presentation about the origin of the Carolina Bays. In the 1930s, researchers proposed that the characteristics of the Carolina Bays could be best explained by impacts, but the failure to find any trace of the projectiles that made the bays eventually led to the idea that the bays were made by the action of waves driven by prevailing winds blowing on pools of water. More recently, the Carolina Bays have been said to be the remnants of ancient thermokarst lakes. Well-preserved Carolina Bays are mathematically elliptical, and this implies that they originated as inclined conical cavities or penetration funnels that would look elliptical when viewed from above. LiDAR images of the Carolina Bays can be easily fitted with ellipses to demonstrate this fact. A penetration funnel is defined as an impact crater, generally funnel-shaped, formed by a small meteorite striking the Earth at a relatively low velocity and containing nearly all the impacting mass within it. In general, penetration funnels are impact craters that form when a projectile strikes a target and transfers its energy without disintegrating. This can only happen when the target material can be displaced by the moving projectile without generating forces that break up the projectile. If you search for penetration funnels on the internet, you will find very few relevant entries. There is a video that I made 4 years ago and a reference to a 2007 paper that describes some craters in Argentina. The 2007 paper describes explosion craters and penetration funnels in the Campo del Cielo, Argentina crater field. The text says that 16 craters have been identified as penetration funnels by their elongated shapes and magnetic anomalies associated with them. All of these craters have a different morphology from the explosion craters, with distinct elongations and smaller diameters and depth-to-diameter ratios. All have large magnetic anomalies below the northeast rim. In each of these, a large mass of iron has been excavated beyond the northeast edge of the crater. These craters are believed to have been created by the impact of nickel iron meteorites with low impact velocities and impact angles. Conical cavities form when a projectile travels through a fluid. A bullet traveling in air forms a conical shockwave whose angle depends on the speed of the bullet. Air resistance decreases the speed of the bullet until it reaches a terminal velocity determined by gravitational forces. High-speed photography can also capture conical shockwaves made by impacts on water. Water is denser than air, and it displays many of the typical characteristics of impact cratering, such as an expanding conical ejecta curtain above the surface. An impact on water creates a cavity and an ejecta curtain. Tiny droplets form by surface tension at the edges of the ejecta curtain. When the energy of the impact stops pushing the water away from the projectile, the cavity in the water collapses toward the center, and the centripetal collapse creates an uplift in the center of the impact zone. When the column collapses, the process is repeated with less energy and forms concentric waves that expand from the point of impact. Water has low viscosity. When all the energy of the impact has been dissipated, the surface of the water becomes level again under the force of gravity. The impact of a projectile on an elastic medium, such as ballistic gel, also forms a conical cavity, but the cavity collapses into a tube after the projectile has passed. A projectile traveling through a non-elastic viscous target produces a typical conical cavity, but the cavity retains the conical shape of the shockwave, unlike the low viscosity and elastic targets. These photographs illustrate an experiment of an ice projectile impacting a viscous target at an oblique angle. When viewed from above, the impact cavity looks elliptical. The overturned flanges excavated by the penetration of the projectile become raised rims around the crater. The target consists of equal parts of sand and pottery clay with enough water to give the mixture the consistency of bricklayer's mortar. Colored sand is used for contrast. The impacts create the cavities in fractions of a second. You need to watch them in slow motion to see the details. Some material is ejected away from the impact point, and some material forms the overturned flanges that become raised rims. A circular shockwave is seen on the surface originating from the point of impact. The Carolina Bays are shallow elliptical basins. If they originated as inclined conical cavities, how did they become almost flat? Viscous relaxation reduces the depth of the conical cavity from the bottom up because hydrostatic pressure increases with depth. This mechanism partially restores the stratigraphy of the terrain, and it is speeded up by the seismic vibrations produced by adjacent impacts. This is a simulation of the oblique impact of an ice projectile on a viscous target with several stratigraphic layers. The projectile produces an inclined conical cavity that traverses the layers, and viscous relaxation reduces the depth of the cavity. The stratigraphy is partially restored as the depth of the cavity is reduced from the bottom up. The ice projectile eventually melts, leaving just a shallow elliptical basin. The LiDAR visualization tool by Michael Davies provides an excellent image of the Carolina Bays near Bowmore, North Carolina. This is a complex landscape where the basins overlap in several ways. The arrow highlights the rim of the basin that was partially overlaid by the central basin. Fitting an ellipse to the visible portion of the rim, we can estimate that the overlaid basin was similar in size to the central basin. Using the law of geological superposition, it is evident that the central basin was created after the overlaid basin. The central basin has a length of 855 meters, that is slightly more than half a mile. The mathematically elliptical geometry and the raised rims around the basins are strong evidence that these basins formed as inclined penetration funnels. The glacier ice impact hypothesis proposes that approximately 12,900 years ago, one or more extraterrestrial impacts on the Laurentide ice sheet ejected pieces of ice in ballistic trajectories. The secondary impacts produced seismic vibrations that liquefied the ground and formed inclined conical cavities. The ice projectile that made this Carolina Bay would have measured approximately 171 meters in diameter, and it would have had impact energy of about 3.5 megatons of TNT with seismic vibrations equivalent to a 7.8 magnitude earthquake. The ice projectile had a diameter about the size of the Washington Monument. The pictures on the left show adjacent experimental penetration funnels as they undergo modification by viscous relaxation. The two conical cavities transform into shallow overlapping basins. The overturned flap of the second impact overlays a portion of the cavity made by the first impact. Only impacts can create overlapping structures like these. The hypothesis that the Carolina Bays were created by uniformitarian wind and water mechanisms, or that the bays originated as thermokarst lakes, cannot explain the features that are observed in the LiDAR images. The wind and water hypothesis, also called the Aeolian-Lacustrian hypothesis, relies on an experiment by Raymond Koshorovsky in a 1977 report that was never published in a peer-reviewed publication, but which has been cited many times by opponents of the impact origin of the Carolina Bays. Koshorovsky carved the circular indentation on a sand tray that he filled with water to represent a model lake and then set a fan to blow over the water. He changed the direction of the fan, as indicated by the arrows, every 15 minutes for 4 hours, and he obtained a shape like a bloated football that he described as elliptical. Proponents of the Aeolian-Lacustrian hypothesis have never attempted to simulate overlapping basins. The idea that the Carolina Bays originated as thaw lakes from permafrost is discussed in a book about dunes and sand sheets of the Atlantic coastal plain by USGS geologist Christopher Suisi. Suisi suggests that the presence of Carolina Bays in North and South Carolina implies that these states had permafrost at one time, even though two different publications say that the southern limit of continuous permafrost during the last glacial maximum was located in central or northern Virginia. The Carolina Bays can be found in Georgia and as far south as northern Florida. Clearly, there was no permafrost that far south, and permafrost lakes are not known to have mathematically elliptical geometry. Physicist Mark Boslow has argued that ice ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on an ice sheet could not have survived the aerodynamic forces of launch and re-entry through the atmosphere. However, Colgan and Aronson report that the compressive strength of glacier ice ranges from 3 to 15 megapascals. This means that only the weakest ice boulders would have fragmented during re-entry, but the ice boulders with compressive strength higher than 10 megapascals would have survived to impact the surface and create Carolina Bays. The story of the Carolina Bays is not complete without including the Nebraska rainwater basins, which are also elliptical. The orientations of the basins in Nebraska and the East Coast converge by the Great Lakes. The elliptical geometry, the raised rims, and the orientation toward a common point are clues that should not be ignored. Hopefully, future generations of geologists will write the whole story of these basins in geology books. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. The Carolina Bays should not be neglected. Ask your geology professors to discuss the Carolina Bays because they are the most prevalent geological structures in the Atlantic coastal plain. There's a link to the LiDAR visualization tool in the description of the video. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays and other scientific topics.